is measures of variation here. What it is mean is, as the slide indicates, mean is same for entirely two different data sets. Or you can say it does not give any much information about spread or variation of data. So I'll go to the Google Colab IPvNB file, which we had the other day. And here I gave about this headers and other things. So we had descriptive statistics, measures of centrality. Here, we'll close this measures of centrality. So it will be hidden, and this also will close. We have to go ahead with the further descriptive statistics. So measures of centrality, we have done with. Now, to start with, again, because we are restarting our session, it is not active from past 2 days. So I had to rerun this import files, because it is common for all. Based on the requirement, we may also add some more packages. Here, for this continuation, we require the same packages which we were using, like NumPy, Pandas, Matplotlib, and Cbond. So now we'll add a new topic here, which is measures of spread or measures of variation. So I'll give H3 here. So measures of variation. So measures of variations. Because I'm giving a header, whatever I type from here, the code, it will come under that. So I can control all all the code snippets with this, because I'm making it as header. So our here, the thing is, I want to give a demo for this particular graph. We'll take some sample values so that the graph look like that, or the diagram look like that, and the mean and mean is same for both the data sets, but the data sets are different. So I'll take a particular data set, like I'll start it with data one again today. To create an array, np dot as array, as we discussed, as I gave the other day. So as array, I'll see that I'll choose the values carefully in such a way that they are very close to each other. So I want to have two data sets which are having values which are close to each other, then one more data set which are spread, but mean is almost remains same. So I'll take the first data set with values which are close to each other. So I'll take some values like 44. So I'll have to choose the values in such a way that they are close to each other. I'll see that somewhere the values are close to each other, and so 44, 44, I'm giving two times, 45, 45, two times, 46, I want to give two times, I'm giving some closer values, then I'll give 47, one time, and I want to make this 47 as middle. So 46 I'm taking two times, so 48 I'll take two times, so that 47 will become mean. So I'll 45 are taken two times, then I'll make 49 two times, so that the mean is 47. Then 44 two times, so to make mean 47, I'll take 52 times. I think this should give mean as 47. We'll see. And they are very close to each other. So I'll say print the mean of this data, np.mean of this data, data one. See, before I run this, I must have run this packages part. So I have run it already. Just this I'll reduce it, and I've run, because here number one is showing, it indicates that it has been executed as first element. Now I am executing this. This will be 2. Data 1, what is that? So I had to give not flower brackets, I had to give this. So this bracket, so that is corrected now. So the mean is 47. Now I'll take one more data set, which is having all values which are spread. Not like very close to each other, and I want to have the mean as same. So I'll take data 2, and I'll see that I'll take some values np dot as array. I want to have mean as 47. So I'll start it with some value. I'll start it with some value 5. I'll see that 5 and 89 will make 47. So then I'll go with some value 10. 10 and I think 84 will make 47. So then I'll go with 20 and 74, so that it is 47. I'm giving the values which are spreading values. So I'll go with the 35 and I'll have 59, so that it is 47. So that is my intention, is I want to have 47 as mean. So I'm taking the values which are spread, but I think 49 I'll give here. Then I'll take 46 and 48, so that 47 is now, if I keep 47 here, I think then it will be the mean. We'll check any mistake, we'll correct it. So print again np dot mean data 2. So it is same. Now I'll draw the graph so that the same appearance will be there, mean is same, but because mean does not give the spread or variation, two different data set, one which are consistent, means very close to each other, and another which has spread. So the variation here cannot be revealed through the measures of centrality. That's why we are going for measures of variation. So if I draw this plot here, SNS, I told you SNS is used to, it is a CBARN package. So I'll say dist plot. The other day I have given data 1. Then I don't want the histogram, so I'll say hist false. So I'll draw both diagrams together. So if you want to draw two diagrams together, then take the another statement, then give the second data set. Now, if we execute together, I think the colors, it will be taken care. We'll see if they don't take the SNS itself should take care of colors. It has to give different colors to two plots. We'll see. If not, it is giving different. See, if you take the red one, the data is spread, and the blue one, data is concentrated. So the mean is the same, but so the mean, because it is measures of centrality, any measures of centrality does not give the spread of the data. So we have to go for measures of variations or measures of spread. So that's why we are going for variance, standard deviation, range, interquartile range. Those things will give the measures of variation of data in the data set. So this is one I want to give a demo, which I did not give. So it is giving the importance of measures of variation. So that is one thing. Next thing is, I think we'll go to this again. Next thing, range is a simple thing. IQR, I'll come back with box plot. Then here, For sample n minus 1 we use to calculate the standard deviation or variance, why we use n for population. Now we know that sample is actually used to estimate the population, because sample is some values taken, some part taken from population, we are calculating the statistics. From statistics we have to estimate the parameter, because if you take attribute like mean, it is a statistics for sample, and same thing will be parameter for population. Now when you take a sample sample average, suppose if I take average, because here x bar is calculated to calculate the standard deviation. Now when you take the x bar, whatever we calculate, it will not be exact replica of the replica of the population, because one sample we may not get everything. Now when you take this x cap, here it will give the minimum. If you take any x cap here, x bar, it will give the minimum standard deviation compared to the value whatever you take other than the x bar. So suppose I'll give you a demo for this, it will be clear. But before that, suppose I got some x bar, means average of sample. So suppose x bar means x bar is average of sample, x cap or x bar. Suppose I'm getting as 25. Now if I take any, because population sample not necessarily be same as the x bar, it will be different. Now if you take any x bar other than 25, it will produce more standard deviation or variance compared to x bar. So that's what it is proved. We'll also see it with a definition. Now because x bar, whatever x bar we are taking, x bar of the sample whatever we are taking, it will produce the minimum standard deviation or variance. It will produce that, we'll see in the demo. So to nullify the effect, because it is giving the minimum standard deviation, surely the population standard deviation will be different from what we get from this x bar. So we to nullify that impact, because it should be more, instead of n we go for n minus 1. That's what one theory says. As per textbook, one theory says that because x bar produces the minimum standard deviation compared to any other value if you take for that x bar, so to nullify that effect, instead of n we go for n minus 1. So that is what the theory says. Now we'll see the proof for that. We'll see the proof for that by taking some example in, because it is also a very important thing. So why that formula? So we'll see some proof. So for that, what I'll do is I'll take some random values. So I'll take some random values for here. I'll attach some comment like y n minus 1. I'll make it bold. The advantage of, as I told you, the advantage of Google Colab is it will allow you to combine the nodes, whatever you want to have with programs. That is the greatest advantage. Y n minus 1 for sample in calculation of standard deviation or variance, whatever it is, but because both will produce the same thing. So that is our question. So I'll take some sample data, some random data as population. So I'll take population as some random data. In Python, you can generate random data by using np.random dot rand int. So I can generate random numbers, either real numbers or integers. So I want to generate random integers. For that, it requires three parameters. One is the range. So what is the range I want to have? I want to have the range of 1 to 100. That means I want to generate integers in between 1 to 100. That is the first two parameters, minimum and maximum, the range. The second thing is how many random numbers you want. So I want to have 200 random numbers. That's what it is actually. So that I will take it as a population. So simply I'll print it. It will give some 200 random numbers in the range 1 to 100. That is what I require. I want to have some random numbers in between 1 to 100. And I want to have 200 such random numbers. So just I'm taking, it does not matter. Now I'll take the standard deviation for this, and standard deviation and variation are measures of spread or measures of spread or variation. So I'll just print. I want to print the standard deviation. So I can have standard deviation with std. In NumPy there is a std function. So I'll apply this to population. Similarly, I'll also go for mean. Just I want to have three standard deviation, mean, and variance. Because this is random numbers, if I click execute it again, I'll get entirely different set, because it will generate random numbers based on some seed value. Most probably the seed value will be time. So it will produce entirely, suppose if I execute again, I'll get entirely different set of random numbers. So here I'm printing the mean. I want to have even variance. It does not matter, because variance and standard deviation will give the same. So for the function for variation is var, function for standard deviation is std. So I'll go for and so I'll print it. So I have population of 200 numbers. Now I want to take a sample from this. So I want to take a sample from this. This function is very useful, because in proving something, you may have to generate the population with random numbers, then pick some sample. And the sample, whatever picked, it should represent the population. So we should not have the pick which is biased. That's what I told you in the beginning. Sample should reflect. So what we'll do is we'll also pick the sample using a random technique. So in Python, readily there is one technique called choice available. So what I'll do is I'll use one code sample here. So sample equals to np.random.choice. What this function does is it will take some population and it will pick some values randomly from population as sample. So that's what we want. We pick some random samples. So here also choice will pick some values from population which we call it as sample randomly. And each time, suppose if I execute 10 times, I'll get a different 10 samples. And as per theory, it says that minimum 30 samples we have to take. Then only the statistics, whatever theory we are having, that will be proved correctly. So I'll go for 40 samples. So I'll take 40 samples and I'll print the mean for this. I'll take it as x cap. So I'll print sample. And I'll take x bar or x cap. I'll take it as x bar equals to, because x bar I cannot represent here as a variable. So I'm using the word bar there. So np.mean sample. So this sample is picked from the. So now if I take print x cap, just I'm printing. So sample is picked from that, and it is printing. I think somewhere some mistake. We have to take, so this x cap I have taken. I'll take x bar and I'll print it. So I'll get some sample as 57. So if I execute this, I'll get a different value. So each time I execute, I'll get a different value. That's what it means. Now here, what the theory says is, here what is x bar value? 49.05. Now if I take any other x bar value other than 49, it will produce the produce more variance or standard deviation compared to the x bar. That's what it is. So for that, I'll write simple logic here. I'll start with here. What I'll do is I'll take some x bar value, or because x bar I'm already using there, I'll take it as x bar 1 I'll take, because I want to have different x bar. So different x bar I want to have. So x bar, so I'll take some value, like what I'm getting there is 50. What is the value I'm getting? 49. So I'll start it with 10. Then I'll see that it is. X bar already have it. So I'll take x bar 1. So while I'll start it with 10.5. So some real number I want to have. While x bar is less than some value, I'll go up to some. For example, 80 or 81, whatever it is, it does not matter. Just I want to prove that. So what I'll do is because I have to calculate the sum of the differences, because to calculate variance, so I'll say square sum equals to zero. So I want to have actually C like code. We can improve this code with Python like code. It will also help you to know about broadcasting capacity of NumPy. So first I want to write the code which look like C code, then we'll change it, and you can know how efficiently and simple way we can write the programs in Python. So I'll take some values for I in range length of sample. So for each value of sample I want to take, so I'll calculate square sum equals to square sum plus equals to what I'll do is sample. So I'll say square sum sample. What we have to do here? Sample I minus x bar one. Because it is square, so I'll in Python square is done with the help of double star, so I can do it with double star. The square sum, then I want to have some variance, VA I'll take it, and square sum, because square sum by n, what is n value here? 40. So I'll take 40. Then I'll print the x bar and variance. So that I want to print. Then I have to take a different x bar. So here x bar 1. So I have to modify the x bar value. So x bar 1 plus equals to 1. I want to increment it by 1. So this is what I want to have. Is it clear, the code? Okay, we'll execute, then we'll see. Sorry, here I should not print. I had to just increment it because next x bar value hard to take, so I should not it is taking so many mistakes. Yeah, already it has. Oh, it is. Sorry, here there is a mistake in the code. I am using X bar, so that is the problem. I should use X bar 1. So if I take this here now, if I take the values here, so here what is the we are getting 49.05. See here, when you take this 49.05 is producing the minimum square, minimum variance. If you take any other value, it is greater than that. That's what you can observe. So what I am doing is I'm taking the, see, X bar is the mean of the sample. Surely the mean of the mean of the population will be different. It may be greater or less. It does not matter. So whatever value you take other than mean, other than the X bar, whatever you got, will surely produce more variance than the X bar. So to nullify that effect, so if you take, this is the minimum value, you take any other value, say 62.8 is the minimum value. After that, you can observe all bigger values. So similarly, if you go up all bigger values, then it is reaching minimum value. So this is why here we have to go N minus 1 for calculation of, because we are predicting population parameter using statistics. So because the standard deviation we produce with X bar will produce a surely a smaller value. To nullify that effect, we are going for N minus 1. That is how the theory says, the theory, and it is also proved from this that it is correct. Whatever theory said, it is correct. So X bar, whatever you take generated from sample, will produce minimum variance compared to any value used as X bar. That's what the theory is proved. Now, this is the code I'm writing. So I'm taking different X bar values and I'm calculating the variance with that different X bar value and checking when it is reaching minimum. So it is reaching minimum when X bar is exactly same as the X bar of the sample. Now, if you take this code normally in Python, we don't write like code like this because it is C-like code. So now when you take here one particular thing, I'm applying this this particular statement. If you take this particular statement, this is we subtract the mean from every element. So this you can broadcast, means that can happen automatically for all the elements instead of taking individual elements. So now what I use here, the code, which will help you to write similar code in Python, is broadcasting. The actually the NumPy allows broadcasting. So I'll modify this code and write it. So the code, it is almost similar, but only thing is that loop I can eliminate to perform the subtraction of mean from each element. That I can do with single statement. That's what we do it. So I'll say X bar, again, I'll use the same logic, or I'll copy this to so that you can know what changes I'm making. That is better, I think. So I'll copy this code and what changes I'm making. So here I want to remove this this one loop. This loop I want to remove because in Python you can do this with single statement with the, because remaining thing we cannot do because we want to take different X bars. So I'll remove this, I'll make this as a comment, and in place of this I'll write the broadcasting code of NumPy. So the logic should be simple. So what I'll do is, I'll say square sum, it is also not, okay, square sum equals to, it is not a cumulative sum, I'll get directly NP sum. So I'm summing and sample. See, earlier, if you observe the code, I'm taking individual elements. Now I'll take the entire array once. So now I'll take x bar 1. So what this does is, it will broadcast this subtraction to all the elements of sample. So broadcasting is the one which spreads all across. Like if you take radio broadcasting, if you speak something, it will send in all directions. So here the subtraction earlier, if you take this example, here I'm doing it with the individual elements. Now instead of individual elements, I'm doing on the entire array. I'm not taking individual element, I'm taking entire array, and it is applicable automatically. So I'm not taking individual elements and broadcasting happens. Then also the square also, this is one more broadcasting. So two broadcastings I'm doing here. So I'm subtracting and also finding square for all the elements. It occurs automatically. So I'm eliminating the loop now. So in place of that loop I'm taking, I'll get the same values. So this is one powerful nature of NumPy. That's what I told you the other day. So NumPy has broadcast facility, which makes the logic very simple. And because I told you the NumPy utilizes the environment, the hardware, mainly the CPU and cache memory in efficient way. So this kind of statement, it will execute faster. If you take individual elements, even if the hardware is very powerful, but the logic will not exploit the power of the environment. But NumPy is written in such a way that it will make use of the hardware to the maximum extent possible. So that's why we are giving a chance to the NumPy to exploit by using broadcasting. So if you don't use broadcasting, then it cannot exploit the hardware properly. So now it is exploiting, it will take very less time. We are not going to measure time. We can in fact measure the time. Now if we execute, I'll get the same result. Somewhere some mistake here. Spelling mistake here. There is a mistake in spelling. So sample is not defined. So take a did. Okay. In. Now it will produce the same result. If you take because I'm just rewriting the code with the broadcasting. So 49.5 is producing the minimum value, like same result what we have seen earlier. It is producing the minimum value, and we are getting the logic is same. Only thing is, here we are using broadcasting. It is more efficient. So even if you take the last value, just to compare, so 49.5, which is sample mean, is producing the minimum value, and 80.5 is producing 1611.7. So here also, if you check 80.5, 1611.7. So this code is very efficient. It is, the important thing is the code is simple. That is one property. And another thing is it is very efficient because it exploits the hardware. So this is one thing. Always, whenever you write Python code, you have to keep in mind that it should exploit the hardware. One thing is, you should always depend on the Python library instead of writing your own code, because the library functions are written in such a way that they utilize the hardware to the maximum extent possible. That's what happening here. So this is, I'll remove this, and I'll say that this is broadcasting. It is using a broadcasting feature. So this is one example for broadcasting. it is a powerful feature of NumPy. Normally, if you take list, if you take other data structure like lists, tuples, sets, they don't have the broadcasting facility. That is, facility is introduced in NumPy. So that is one thing I want to give, and I think. We'll go to the other things of, I think this is done. Now we'll go to box plots. So see, I told you, when you take the measures on spread, it will give this spread. So that spread can be utilized, can be seen properly with the help of box plot. So box plot is another type of graph used in Python to see the spread of the data. So when you take the box plot, it has five components, like minimum is one component, maximum is another component, median, Q1, Q3. These are, it is five components will be there, minimum, maximum, median, Q1 and Q3. Actually, it is a quartile. It divides the diagram into four equal parts, which is Q1, Q3 up to Q4. So Q0 to Q1 is one part, Q1 to Q2 is another part, Q2 to Q3 is third part, Q3 to maximum is another part. That's what it is does. And when you take this IQR, which is interquartile range, which is Q3 minus Q1, it will have 50% of the values. And mainly we concentrate on these values because it will eliminate the outliers. And when you take this line here, border lines, there is one border line shown at the left side, another border line, they are called as whiskers. So in box plot, there is IQR diagram, there are whiskers. So whiskers are the boundaries of the box plot. And whisker, how it is calculated, whisker value, if you take whisker value here, minimum value is calculated like Q1 minus, here formula is given. So Q1 minus, Q1 minus 1.5 into IQR. IQR, you know, Q3 minus Q1, that is minimum value. Q3 plus 1.5 into IQR is the maximum value. Now, if you take the outlier, any value beyond the minimum and maximum. If a value, any value beyond minimum and maximum is called as outlier. So this is how the box plot is drawn, and it will give several information. Like as I told you, the box plot is used to visualize the spread of the data, how data is spread. And also it is used to visualize the median, outliers, because outliers are extreme values. They are not, they are odd man outs, and the outliers are actually less than minimum and greater than maximum. And the minimum and maximum are called as whiskers. So beyond whiskers, whatever values are present, they are called as outliers. And so outliers are also be used to visualize outliers. To some extent, skewness can also be identified. Skewness, I'll give you next. I'll give you what is skewness exactly. Already I have given the skewness briefly in the beginning. We can also calculate skewness using some formula. So this is actually the box plot, and it is also, if you go to machine learning, so it when you have multiple systems to compare the different systems, we use box plots. Side by side we display, suppose we have two ML systems. For ML system model one, whatever it has generated, we draw a box plot, and for second ML system, we draw a box plot and compare the ML system. So box plots are not only used to visualize some data, but also they are used to compare the different ML systems. Now we'll write some code to get the box plots, and we'll see this. And here I'll go back again to this. I'll write here some heading like box plots. So So this time what I'll do is I'll not generate data or write the data manually. I'll read the data from some Excel file or CSV files. So in when you take the data, mostly is available in CSV file, comma separated values file. For most of the ML systems, even if you take the social networking systems, most of the data, it is available in mostly in comma separated values, and these days it is also available in JSON form. So we'll see a comma separated file, and we'll read comma separated file and draw the box plot for that. So I'll take some file which is there with me already. It is actually a real data. I have it with me. You will also know how to load that data into Python and how to use that data. So here I have one file. From here onwards, we'll be using several Excel files, and we'll be using that data to do our further program. So I have data called real estate price size. So real estate price and size. So this is the comma separated file. It has two columns. One is price and size of house. So in, I think it is in square feet. I think it is in square feet. So it is, this is some US data. It is in actually in dollars. So 643 square feet, and these are the 23,430, 34,314. I think somewhere I got this data. So we'll use this data and we'll try to generate the box plot for this. So so if you want to use any file, what you have to do is first you have to load it. And before you load it, because you are using Google Colab, so that file should be brought into this environment. So here I'll upload a file. But remember that because this is a working environment, so whenever you see whatever code you write, it will be automatically saved in Google Drive. But whatever file you upload, they will be removed after this session. So if you are using some data files, then each time you start your new session, you have to load them separately. So I think I have kept it somewhere in desktop. So I'll put this here. So now that file is available here. So Pandas is the package used here to load it. So I'll say normally Pandas will have two things, data frame and series. I told you data frame is for tabular data and series for time series data. We will not be using series right now. So Pandas is with pd.read_csv is the file, so the function. So I'll name the file here, whatever name I've given here, real estate underscore price underscore size. So this is the file. It will be loaded into this, and CSV I have to give here. I have to give the extension also. That is the problem. So whatever data, if you want to view the data, you can use head to view some five records, I think. So five records, I can view it. So I have this, so I'm viewing 5 records. So I, if I want to know how many records or tables are there, I can say df.shape will give the different records here. So sorry, not zero. So if I execute the number of rows and columns, sorry, shape is not a function, it's a property. So I should use shape here. So when it is a property, no brackets. So there are 100 rows and two columns. Two columns are displayed here, like price and size. So that's what I have. And one more important thing you can use when you have pandas is describe. It will give all descriptive properties in a brief way. So this is very important feature which we can use it here. So I'll say df dot print df dot describe. It will give the different parameters, different parameters of the whole thing. So for price, it is giving number of records there, mean for price, then standard deviation, minimum value, 25th quartile, 25th quartile and 50th quartile, which is median, then 75 Q3, which is 75% maximum. So it is giving minimum, maximum, which is range, IQR, everything it is giving. So describe is very popular one to know glimpse of the data. So if I want to know the glimpse of the data, we can use this describe is very popular, and in even machine learning models, when you develop, before you start doing anything, first see some parameters like mean, standard deviation. So describe is very popularly used. Next, I want to draw a box plot for that. So to draw box plot, the simple thing is SNS dot box plot, and I'll give the data. So I have to give one of the columns. So I'll say data price. So if I want to refer one column, I can say the column name label there, and I can click this. It is not data because I have loaded into df, so it is not data, so I have to say df. So now it is giving the box plot. So if you take the box plot, this is the box plot. So you can observe that there is one outlier. 1800 is outlier here. So whatever here, when you take the dot here, is an outlier because it is beyond the range. Remaining, suppose if you go to this Excel file and check it. So if you take this 1842 is outlier because it is beyond the values. So at 1800, almost after 1800, so this is outlier. And median is somewhere here. I think median is around 700. We'll check here because this line will give, because here there are so many values between this. So the median line is shifted here. So from this diagram, you can get some information. So if you take 696 is median, so around 700, as I told you, or around 700, because this middle line gives the median. So that is what the box plot gives. So box plot gives some information like median, the IQR. So IQR is somewhere here around 625 to 1025, which is Q1 and Q3. So here 643 and 1029, that is IQR. From this also you can identify. So this indicates that there are many values concentrated between Q2 median and Q1. That's why it has shifted. There are several values here, but they are spread. So this bigger area of the box indicates that values are spread, and the smaller area indicates that it is concentrated, and this dot indicates that there is an outlier. So It is slightly skewed because the box is shifted towards left, so it is because concentration is on left side and there are values at the right side, so that is actually the box plot. You can infer so many things from box plot. So that is the box plot. Next, I think we'll go to this skew. We'll see skew here. So that is box plot. Now we'll see skew. Skewness is actually, it is measure of asymmetry. So if skewness is zero, like here, as I indicate, if skewness is zero, the data is symmetric. And positive skewness indicates that bulk of the data is at left side, and negative skewness indicates that bulk of the data is at right side. So this is skewness, and the formula is sum of elements minus mean divided by sigma, which is actually the variance cube, is skewness. So skewness is a third order element. If you take standard deviation, second order, and mean is first order, so this is third order element, and it will give the asymmetry of distribution. Skewness zero indicates that the data is spread properly. The data is spread properly. That means data is symmetric at both sides, and you can easily find skewness with a simple function in Python. So I'll go to this code. I'll draw this skew, print this skewness. It is a simple code here. So I'll say print. The same data I'll take df size. So size. Yeah, if you take here, see the value is above one, so it is right skewed. As I told you, most of the data is concentrated on left side. It is right skewed, so this is indicating that it is right skewed. I can also apply this skew function on the entire data frame at a time. I can say df skew. That means it will give the skewness for both the columns. So price, this is the skewness, so it is also right skewed, but slightly, and this is also right skewed, it is more. So skewness indicates how the data is spread. For example, suppose we have taken some some statistics here, measures of centrality, where I told you the data is symmetric. We'll check whether how skewness is working there, so that it will be clear. So I have said that this is symmetric. So we said that the data is symmetric. So when the data is symmetric, one thing is mean, median, and mode will be same. And we can also observe that the skewness must be zero, because skewness indicates, what skewness indicates is, it indicates this asymmetry of distribution. So no skewness means it is symmetric. So when it is symmetric, the data, the skewness should be zero. So I'll say here, int data one, I had to rerun again because this I did not run. Now I'll say data one, print. I think skew is okay. I'll say the one is the end. Say NP. I think because it is not a data frame. If it is a data frame, it will be executed directly. So it is a NumPy array. So what I'll do is, NumPy does not have skewness function. Simply what I'll do is I'll convert this into data frame. So to convert this into data frame, I'll say data frame. I'm converting, that is, I think, better because data one is not a data frame. Data, the skewness is property of data frame. So I'll say df1.skew. Now I should, I think I should get it because skew is only for a function of pandas, not NumPy. So I'll say print. Now I'll execute this. Data frame is not defined. Oh, sorry. I had to give here PD data frame because it is pandas one, so I cannot directly use it. Now it is zero. So when you take the skewness of this data, it is zero because it is symmetric. Now I'll go to the one which is right skewed. We have used it right, both left skewed and right skewed. So this is right skewed, and the data should be the skewness should be positive. We'll check whether it is for, if it is symmetric skewness, you are getting it as zero. If it is right skewed, this I told you it is right skewed as the diagram indicates, data two, I think. Yeah, data two. So again, I'll convert this into data frame because data is a NumPy array. So I'll say pandas dot data frame data two. Now I'll print it, print df2. Because data 2 is not, this I have to execute because I have not executed. Now I'll execute. Now I'll print. I'm printing df2. So I have to say df2 skew, not. Check. So it is a positive value. So skew is a positive value here. Positive value indicates that it is right skewed. Now I'll go to the data 3. First I'll execute data 3. Now I should get negative value. Negative skewness indicates it is left skewed. Positive skewness indicates it is right skewed. So as per the diagram, we are saying that it is left skewed. Then I'll create one more data frame 3 equals to pd dot data frame, then I'll say data 3. Then I'll print skew, print f3 dot skew. So I must get negative value, we'll see. So there is a negative value. So when it is negative, it is actually left skewed, positive right skewed, and zero it is symmetric. That's what here, when you take this both, when you take price and size, they are right skewed data, both are positive. So both positives are here displayed. See here, when you take this zero, if you have confusion, because data frame has columns, so I don't have name. This is index of the column. There is only one column, that index of the column, and this is the skewness. Now, when you take this, so there is index, only one index, so no name, so it is giving index. So the skewness is 996. Next, when you take this, one column, no name, so index it is giving. Now, when you take this data frame, which has two columns here, two columns, it is giving the name of, because there are labels are associated with this, labels associated. So it will use the label and it gives the skewness. That is about the skewness. I think that's about the descriptive statistics. We have completed descriptive statistics. I have covered almost everything. I have covered demos. Next, we go to, because there is shortage of time, inferential statistics. So when you take the inferential statistics, I told you it is inferential statistics are used to draw some conclusions from the statistics, draw some insights. So to know what is happening in the there, whether data is used or as per the requirement or not. So we to draw some insights and draw some insights and draw some conclusions. We use in and see, the important thing is the inferential statistics are based on probability. And there are two popular techniques to draw inferences. One is confidence interval, another is hypothesis test. Both are used to get some estimation. It is actually because we want to estimate some parameter from based on the sample. Based on the availability of information, they act differently. See that each one, but that brief some concepts like when you take random variables, because when you take this inferences, it is based on probability theory and statistics. Based on probability theory and statistics. So when you take this random variable, because they are drawn from some samples and they have chance, every picking up everything is a chance. So it is random, and because it may take any value from available values, so it is a variable. And when you have discrete means specific values, it is taking a continuous value. Then when you take the distribution, distribution is actually distribution is function that shows possible values from variable and how often they occur. That's what distribution, because it is a frequency. We calculate how often occur is actually the frequency. So if it is discrete probability distribution, if you work with discrete variables, binomial distribution, Poisson's distribution. If it's continuous probability distribution, we go uniform distribution. When you take this, mostly we work with continuous probability distribution. Some of the random variables are continuous, and that too, most of the random variables are normal. That is one reason. There is one more reason why we work with normal distribution, I'll tell you. So, mainly, we discuss normal distribution because there are so many use cases. I have designed 2-3 use cases based on normal distribution. So, most of the random variables are continuous, and they exhibit normal distribution properties rather than uniform. So, we go for normal distribution. That is one thing. Why we go for normal distribution? And already we have seen it is symmetric, and mean and median mode are almost same, exactly same. Uniform distribution take all values same. It is not increasing and decreasing, and it is continuously increasing or continuous. Here, normal distribution is very common thing. And these are the properties. Normal distribution is also another name to normal distribution, and it is bell-shaped curve, and it is symmetric about mean. So there is a mean here. It is symmetric about mean, and there is the actually it is measure of if you take the values of this distribution, they are actually how many standard deviations away from mean will be given. That's what the one more property of normal. And if you take the second diagram here, if you vary the mean, distribution remains same. It will slide towards left or right. That's what it is happening. So if you take this dashed line, this is the C is the original normal distribution. If you vary the mean, standard deviation or variance remains same. That is one thing. So if you keep standard deviation constant and vary the mean, it will slide towards right. Keep the mean constant and vary the standard deviation variance, it will its spread will decrease or increase. So this is the green line has spread has decreased. So there is a steep
there. So sir, your voice is breaking, sir.
Now is it okay, madam?
It's little bit low, sir. I don't know why. So far it is fine, but
sometimes
for past few minutes it's breaking on low voices.
Now is it okay? Still the problem?
Somewhat breaking, sir.
I think it is continuously we are using network now, I think. Now is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So that is normal distribution, and we mainly depend on normal distribution. That is because most of the random variables, they exhibit normal distribution. One more thing which is making us to study normal distribution is the central limit theorem. So this is very important theorem. We'll also prove whether it is correct or not from our data here. What central limit theorem states is, whatever may be the distribution of population may have any distribution. It may have exponential distribution or any other distribution, but sampling distribution of the sample means will be normal. This is very important. So what this says is, if I have we'll prove it with some demo. If you have, suppose I have population of 1,000 data items, now I'll pick one sample of 100 data items randomly. I'll pick another sample of another 100 data items randomly. Like that, if I pick, suppose from 1,000, I can pick any number. So if I'm picking 20 different samples, now if I take each sample mean, the sample mean exhibit the normal distribution. That's what it says. So whatever may be the distribution of population, we'll take the example. It will be a similar example what we have drawn. Whatever may be the distribution of the population, but if you take the samples, this is very important property. If you take different samples and if you take this mean of all the samples, and those mean of all the samples, they exhibit normal distribution. So that's why normal distribution is very important in machine learning, because not only because most of the random variables exhibit normal distribution, but also because of the central limit theorem. So mostly we study normal distribution, and there are several use cases using this normal distribution. So before we proceed with any other thing, we'll actually prove the central limit theorem, because it is very important. So what I'll do is I'll go back. It will also clear you the definition of this central limit theorem. So I'll go and create one more header here. Central limit theorem. So I'll take some 1,000 samples, because 1,000 population. So I'll say population data. I'll name it. Already I have. It's okay even if I use the same thing. So I'll say np.random.randint. I'll go again with randint. I want to have some 200 range of numbers, 1 to 200. I want to have 1,000 numbers in that range. So I'll display the, okay, I have taken this. Now I'll see what is the distribution it is following. Because that's what I, to the central limits theorem says that whatever may be the distribution of population, then the means of the samples taken will exhibit the normal distribution. That's what we have seen. So dist plot, I'll plot the population. I'll say pop data. I'll say hist equals to false because I don't want the histograms. I want only that curve. It is not normally distributed. It is somewhat, see, it is not normally distributed. There is something. Suppose if I rerun again, if I take a different sample, I'll get a different diagram, slightly different. So again, run it, I'll get a different diagram. So whatever may be the shape of, so run it again, I'll get a different diagram. Whatever may be the shape of the population, it may be anything. So just I'm running several times. It does not matter. I'll get a different shape. So I'm getting a different shape. Now what I'll do is I'll take some samples. How many samples I want to take? I'll take 50 samples. It is any number I can take. Some minimum 30 samples and sample size should be minimum 30. That rule you have to follow. So what I'll do is I'll take an array to have sample mean because we want to see the distribution of sample mean. So I'll say an array, I'll store in array here. I'll take a list as array. So I'll keep on add it. I want to take for. I don't want information about the sample. I want only information about the mean of the sample. I am not much bothered about the sample data. I am not going to see it. I'll pick a sample, calculate the mean, ignore the sample, take another sample, pick another sample, calculate the mean, store it, ignore that sample. That way I want to give, because I want to have nearly, it is up to us, I want to have nearly 50 samples. I'll take 50 samples and first I'll take sample here. Pick like we did already, like np.random.choice will allow us to pick some sample. So what is the data population? Pop data is the population. So how many elements you want to have in the sample? I want to have 100 elements, so I'll say 100. So I'm picking 100. I will not bother about what is there in sample. I want to just calculate sample mean. So I'll say, because it's a list, I can append it using append method. So I'll say sample mean append, mean dot append, np dot mean sample. So this is my requirement. I'll not bother about the sample. Again, this is repeated. New sample is taken and new sample is taken. Mean is calculated and saved. That's what I want. Now, I have the array of means of the samples. So I got the array of means of the samples. Now I'll see the distribution, how it look like. So whether central limit theorem is proved or not, we'll see. Plot sample mean. And hist I don't want, hist equals to false. See, you can observe, see, the distribution is almost, it is exactly normal distribution. This is what what I'll do is, I'll also print skewness for this, because, okay, I'll print mean and median. mode I cannot print because it may have multi mode, so it may not give correct result. So I'll say sample mean array, then np dot median. So when it is normally distributed, it should be its mean and mode should be almost same, may not be exactly same because it is not. So if I calculate this, see there, you can observe they are exactly almost same. See 98.78, 98.82. See this, see I am taking population distribution is different, but I am getting normal distribution. You can also prove it with skew. To get skew, I had to depend on data frame. So I'll say pd dot data frame dot this sample mean, because this is actually not a data frame. So I'll say print df dot skew. So it is almost nearer to zero, but slightly skewed, but almost nearer to zero. Now the median and mode also proving that it is normally distributed. Now I'll take a different I'll take a different samples. If I execute this, population remains same, but different samples, I'll get almost same, but slightly different. Now see, any number of times you do, you will get almost. See here also it is 98.86, 98.24, and skewness we'll check. Skewness we'll check, and if you check this skewness, it is slightly right skewed. Now again, I'll change the population. I'll get a different shape for population because I'm picking the random numbers. I'll get a different shape. So now I'll take one more because it. So I'm getting a different shape for population. I'll take the sample means. And almost 101.5, 100.91, almost the same mean and median. And shape is also indicating that it is see, it is almost normally distributed, and I'll get the skew. It is almost nearer to zero. So this is central limit theorem. This is the reason. So central limit theorem states that whatever may be the distribution of population, whatever may be the distribution of the population, the samples, if you take, see, the sample size must be minimum 30. That is one important property. Minimum 30 size sample you have to take, any number of sample you take. So yeah, I think some disturbance. So the calculate mean of all the samples, then display the distribution. It is almost any number of you execute, you'll get almost same shape. Not necessarily exactly normally distributed, almost symmetric, almost same shape you'll get it. So this is central limit theorem. That is the reason why the normally distribution plays an important role in statistics and also machine learning. So that is the one, and I think next is jet scores. Okay, I will cover this and stop because it is almost 4:30. Jet scores, standardization, which will lead to jet score. See, when you take the data, and sometimes suppose I'll take one data, whatever I have. So we'll check which one is suitable. Uh, city car. Okay, car data I'll take. Yeah, car Excel. Okay, we'll take car Excel data. Now, when you take this car Excels, one very limited number of records I have taken. This is engine capacity CC, age of the car in months, age of the car in months, so the price of the car. Now, if I want to set relationship between these data items and if I want to build a model, the problem I face is it will be biased towards the higher values. Like if I take age is in all two digits and CC is in four digit number and price is a five digit number. So a lot of bias towards price will be there. So whenever you want to have like distance, because in case of machine learning, we also do distance kind of thing between two parameters or attributes or terms. So whichever algorithm depends on distance, and if there is a variation in the magnitude of that attribute, then there will be surely bias in the model. So it will not get the correct model. In this type of situation, what we have to do is we have to go for standardization of data. We have to standardize the data, bring all of them into almost one range by not disturbing its originality. That is actually the thing. So standardization here, as per this slide, standardization comes into picture when features of input data set have large differences between their ranges. So ranges, there are large, huge differences. So if you take this is 2270 to 21500, there is, but the range here, age of range is small. So huge difference in the range means different magnitudes are there. Then the distance, whatever we calculate, it will not have proper result. So we have to standardize the data. So there are two ways. One is standardization, another is normalization. But JET scores are very important. We use, there are several use cases using JET scores. So we go for standardization. In standardization of data, what you can do is, you can take the element, subtract the mean and divide it by variance, you'll get standard deviation, you'll get the JET score that will make it uniform. So just I'll give one Excel demo for this and we'll stop. So I'll take this normalized value, standardized values. So I'll say CC standard. So what I have to do here is I have to take the mean average of this. With Excel also you can do lot of the statistics. You can do whatever we do with Python. Most of the things you can also do it with Excel. So I'll go for, this is, I think it has given some, we have to go for average. So I'll take average. I'm getting average and standard deviation I have to take. And standard deviation, if you take, there are two types of standard deviations available. You have to go with the population standard deviation. So that is what, so P, I think we have to add P. Yeah, it's correct. So I'm getting standard deviation. Now take this. So this is equal to this one minus this one. X minus mean, that you keep it in bracket. And divided by standard deviation. I'm taking population standard deviation. So two types of standard deviations. Minus divided by this. So now apply this for all. It will convert into some range with around 1. Now, if I want to apply this, I think I have to make this as a constant. So that's what I think we had to do. Wait for 1 and you can. So it is now applicable to. This is all in, so minus positive values will be there, and I can do it for A's, and this is a Z score, Z value, and this is X, and this is a Z value. So I'm using X minus mean divided by standard deviation, I'll get Z. I can do it for this also, 1 I'll do it, and here I have to calculate this. So average. Then standard deviation for PD. So can extend this to, so if you take all of them coming in one range, so range is almost same, so it is between around 1 minus 1 and 1. So now there will not be any bias of the data. So this is how what Z scores. So there are several use cases on Z scores. Actually, I want to have at least confidence interval. There are some use cases, but there are some exercises I want to do, but I think time is not permitting. Anyhow, I'll do this exercises and share with you the IPVNB file, this file. This file I'll share, I'll add some more code, whatever exercises I have planned, I'll add that code, and I'll also share this PPT with you, then I think it will cover anything. I'll also add, like, I thought of giving even the regression, at least linear regression with a single value, multi-value. Because we are going hands-on, so it is taking time. So I think we can stop. I'll share whatever possible with you. Nitya, madam. Yeah, madam.
Yes, sir.
Shall we conclude?
Sir.
Shall we conclude? Stop.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir.
I'll share whatever, because it is not possible to cover everything. Whatever I have covered, I think I'll share PPT. I'll give it to you. You please circulate them.
Sir, at the end of the day, we will share all 5-day PPT, recorded video, everything we shall share together, sir.
Yeah, I'll forward it to you. IPVNB file, that collab file, it will open only in Jupyter or collab. So I'll share with you that, and you even PPT, you can please share with that. And I think my session is closing today, and thank you for all of you for patiently listening, and I'm happy if I can share my knowledge with somebody. So people there, so I'm happy to be further sessions, if possible in future, we can plan. Thank you, Madam Nitya, Madam. Thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Yes. For session, sir, since our class, kindly join the session using the same link. All the 5 days. Thanks. Thank you, sir. Sir?